What's up, Palms Church? So excited to be back with y'all after a couple of weeks getting some refreshed and going on some vacation, enjoying some time with my family. So excited to be back. But before I do anything else, I want to take a moment. I want to recognize those that have really spoken into y'all's lives over the last couple of weeks. I want to thank Pastor Corey for bringing such an incredible word last week, talking about the Advent and love, joy, peace, and hope, and just the things that that means. If you didn't hear that message, you need to go back and listen to it. Pastor Corey brought us a power-packed message, a great teaching word that really is challenging but encouraging as to what this whole season even means, what this time means. And then I also want to thank my wife, Pastor Casey Shank, for sharing with us on Wednesday night. You guys have been blessed. You have so many gifts that have been given to this church by God in the form of people, staff, people who can communicate, as well as a lot of the dream team, all of the dream team. So can we take a minute and just throw some balloons and some cakes up in those? Maybe just something fun. Throw them up in that chat just to thank all of those who have poured into you the last couple of weeks. I am just so grateful for our team and so grateful for our staff, and just thankful for the people that are paying such a dear price to make sure that we are all healthy during this time. They're interceding and praying and asking God for those things, and just really grateful for that and all that God is doing. I'm pumped about this series. The greatest gift ever given was Jesus, right? That was the gift that was given to us, and it was this incredible gift, and it was this gift that changed all of humanity. But I think sometimes we forget the value of the gift because I think we forget what happened before the gift ever came. You know, I think we forget what time looked like to the people who were receiving the gift. Maybe we forget the stories that kind of started and helped the gift become what it needed to be. Maybe we forgot how the DNA was built before God sent Jesus. And that's really what I want to take you to. We're going to be kind of all over the place in this next couple of weeks. We have a lot of things that we're really looking forward to. We're looking forward to the Together Conference this week. We're looking forward to Christmas Eve services that are going to be running all day. We're producing a service that we can't wait for you to see. We think it's going to be something you can play on the background while everybody's making those cookies and eating those pies and opening presents and just being with family. We want to provide something that can just be a part of your day. And so we're just excited about all that God is doing. For those of you that are new to Palms, you know, Palms Church made a decision back in April. We really felt the Lord speak to us that we were going to build our online campus robust. We were going to build this thing so that we could really reach the world, and we're doing that. So I want to welcome everybody in from all over the world, all over the country. We got California, we got Ohio, we got Indiana. We got people from all over, so welcome to Palms Church. But next year, we're going to start sharing some vision as to what that's going to look like as we start to physically get back together. But I just want to honor as well all the CDC and the government, and I just want to thank all those healthcare workers that are paying a dear price to keep us safe and to help us get back to health. And so I'm excited about what God's doing in the month of December. I believe these next couple of months could be some of the greatest months of your life. I was just telling one of our dream teamers before I came on that when we physically meet next year, it's going to be incredible, all these people that have been worshiping in their homes for a year, when they stand back together in that room, they're not going to be worshiping just together, but they're going to be worshiping their story. They're going to be worshiping what God did. They're going to be worshiping the gifts that he's given them in their life and the details and the things that he's done. And so I cannot wait for those moments. But today I want to take you to the book of Exodus. In Exodus, Moses had just come on the scene and he had told the Israelites, hey, God sent me. You're going to be delivered after hundreds of years in slavery. I know that there was a promise given to you that you were going to be God's people and he was going to do great things through you. But it's been hard to see that over the last 430 years because you've been enslaved. You've been the people that the Egyptians have belittled, the ones that the Egyptians have used for their betterment. The Egyptians have used you to make their bank accounts bigger. The Egyptians have used you to make their country greater. The Egyptians have used you to make their lives easier. And what God is saying to them through Moses is that, hey, I've got a way out, and it's me. It's the King of all kings. It's God. It's Jehovah Jireh. It's Jehovah Nissi. It's the Almighty. And they're excited about this. But then in Exodus chapter 6, things change a little bit. In Exodus chapter 6, Moses relays a promise to them and something that God spoke directly to him on their behalf. And then they have a little bit of a conversation. And in Exodus chapter 6, we're going to start in verse 6. So what it says. It says, therefore, so God's telling Moses, this is what you say to them. Therefore, say to the people of Israel, I am the Lord. I will free you from your oppression and I'll rescue you from your slavery in Egypt. And I don't know about you, but I like it whenever God speaks promising things over my life. I like it when he tells me something great's about to happen. Y'all like that? When God says something good's about to happen, I always say, hey, man, if God is blessing my friends or my neighbors, that is good because that means he's in the neighborhood and he's got to come down the street at some point. But you really look at what God does. He's always blessing us and he's always pouring out things in our life and doing things that we couldn't do on our own. But it says, I'll free you from your oppression. I'll rescue you from your slavery in Egypt. I'll redeem you with the powerful arm and great acts of judgment. I will claim you as my own people and I will be your God. Then you will know that I'm the Lord your God who has freed you from your oppression in Egypt. It says, I'll bring you into the land I swore to give to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and I'll give it to you as your very own possession. I am the Lord. I love how God always repeats his identity, but I wish he didn't have to. You know, I love how he does it to remind us, and it's really because he's intimate and he's a promising dad that he repeats his identity. But I wish that we had the kind of faith where God knew that he never had to do that to assure us that daddy's there. You know, it's really because of our lack of faith that God has to constantly remind us who he is. Now, he does it because he loves us. He does it because he wants us to know. And I get that. I tell my boys every time, love you guys, love you guys. We'll be riding in the car. Hey, guys, love you. Hey, guys, love you. Hey, guys, I love you. So God, that's why God does it. He tells us he's the Lord. But I wish that our faith was so strong that we would know that without having to hear it all the time. You know, without having to hear that he's still with us. You know, you have a bad day or a bad week. Oh, what's going on? No, he's still with us. So in verse 9. It says, so Moses told the people of Israel what the Lord had said, all these promises, all these great things. And then it says, but they refused to listen anymore. So God's promises had never changed, but they just got sick of hearing promises that they didn't see fulfilled, things that they couldn't see happening. They felt like their life wasn't in a place where things were happening fast enough at a pace that was good enough. And so they just stopped listening to God. And it says they had become too discouraged by the brutality of their slavery. And I feel like today, maybe some of you are just overwhelmed by the brutality of the season. You're overwhelmed by the brutality of the slavery. Maybe for some of you, it's a drug addiction that you just can't seem to kick. Maybe for some of you, it's an addiction to pornography, or it's an addiction to alcohol, or maybe for some of you, it's an addiction to people that aren't healthy. Maybe for some of you, it's an addiction to things that shouldn't be said and you keep saying them, or it's an addiction to a mindset that's actually keeping you from things. You're wondering why something looks healthy, but yet you don't know if it's healthy. You're addicted to the wrong people. You're addicted to the wrong relationships. You're addicted to divisiveness and you don't realize it. You're addicted to gossip and you don't realize it. You're addicted to things that actually pull you from God, but you wonder why you can't get close enough to God because you're addicted to the wrong things. And you're overwhelmed and distracted and discouraged because of the amount of slavery that you're in. And you're thinking, why do I not feel free? Because our addictions have bound us to something that God's already freed us from. You see what I'm saying? And that's really where the Israelites were at. They did become discouraged by their slavery. They became, and I love how the scripture says it. It says they were discouraged by the brutality of their slavery. This is a stark difference from Exodus chapter 4. Exodus chapter 4, verse 31, we're going to go back two chapters. This is when Moses initially told them, God is going to deliver you from the Egyptians. We're going to march up out of here and we're going to be freed. So this is when the vision came and before the season of where the promise didn't look as promising. Exodus chapter 4, verse 31, it says, the people of Israel were convinced. So now we're going before this. Moses spoke to them. It says, the people of Israel were convinced that the Lord had sent Moses and Aaron. And it says, and when they heard that the Lord was concerned about them and had seen their misery, they bowed down and they worshiped. So what happened between Exodus chapter 4 and Exodus chapter 6? Well, what happened was that the promise was that I'm going to free you. The promise was that I'm going to take you to a place that only I can take you. The promise was that I'm going to do things in your life that only I can do. And everybody is like, yes, let's go. I want to be having this move of God. And I want this move of God in my life to do things that only God can do in a way only God can do them. Y'all like that, right? I like that. So what happened between the place where it says they heard the promise and they bowed down in worship to the place where they said they were discouraged because of the brutality of their slavery? Well, I'll tell you what happened. When God makes a promise, there's always going to be a resistance because spiritual warfare is real. Now, I told my wife this week, I said, you know, I don't understand why we feel like if there's not enough people praying that miracles don't happen, because I think it's not about the amount of people praying. I think it's about the faith of the people that are praying. You know what I said? I don't think it's about making sure that everybody you know is praying as much as it is about making sure the people you know that have faith are praying. Because this is the thing. It's not that there's more people praying against you than for you, and so whoever has more wins. That's not the way that it works. What it says is the Bible says the power or the prayer of a righteous man is powerful and effective. A righteous man, a righteous woman. You don't need an army. You need a righteous person, right? And so this scripture, what it's really helping us see is that there was this lackadaisical disconnect in Exodus chapter 4 to 6. What happened was Moses and Aaron, they had the promise of God. They told the people bowed down and worship. But then they went to the Pharaoh, the king, and they said, this is what's going to happen. You're going to let our people go. And the king said, you've lost your mind. And so what the king did was he got mad and he told the Israelites that were his slaves building his kingdom, you're going to build the same things. And there was bricks made out of straw and clay. And he said, you're going to build the same things, but yet we're not going to go get the straw for you. I want the same quota, but you're going to have to go and get your own straw. We're not going to deliver it. It's not going to be ready for you to assemble. And so the quota stayed the same, and the people had to go out, get the straw, come back, make the bricks with the same amount of effort, the same amount of expectation. Well, they couldn't meet the quota. And so these foremen, these Israelite foremen were starting to get whipped, And all the people would watch these guys get whipped because they couldn't meet the quota. Well, then Pharaoh gets even more angry when the foreman come to him and say, stop treating us like this. He gets even more angry and he says, you know what I'm going to do? Now I want you to make bricks, but I want you to make it without straw and the same quota. And it's an extremely difficult process. There's nothing to hold it together. There's nothing to stabilize the bricks. And so now these Egyptians were oppressing the Israelites because God said, I'm going to release you. And there was a spiritual hold on the Israelites that said, no, you will be held down, because if you're not held down, then God will be seen by others through your life. If I don't hold you down, then there is a great chance that the Holy Spirit and the power of God is going to be seen in your life and people are going to want what you have. And so there was a fight. And the fight came through a Pharaoh who said, I want you to make bricks with straw, but you're going to get your own straw now. And then it went to the place, I want you to make bricks without straw. And we get to chapter 6, and the people are so discouraged, they tell Moses and Aaron, just leave us alone. We are discouraged by the brutality of our slavery. Because what happens is when you're enslaved and you start to come out of something and it's harder than when you were enslaved, you want to go back to the thing that felt like comfort, but it was really just captivity. And they're frustrated, and they're overwhelmed, and they're not sure what's going to happen, and they're not sure that they want it to happen. But you know, sometimes I feel like you just need somebody to believe in you. You just need to know that somebody believes in you. You just need to know that God sees you and he believes in you. I remember when I started my master's program in 2012, I didn't have an awful undergrad, but when I went to Evangel University, I transferred out of George Mason University, of which I didn't want to attend. Not that the school was bad, I just didn't want to go to college because I was too focused on this cute little thing named Casey Dunaway at the time. So I stayed close to home when I shouldn't have, and my grades barely made it. I had to get a certain GPA to play football at Evangel, and I squeaked by the skin of my teeth to transfer with that GPA, and it was not good. I don't even remember what it was. It was closer to a 2 than a 4, I'll tell you that. And so when I get to Evangel University, it took me the next 3 years to dig out of an awful GPA just for my starting freshman year, and I graduated with an okay GPA, not sure exactly what it was. But when I went to apply for my master's program, they told me, everything is good, you're good to go, we just need a reference from a professor of higher level education to get you into the program because of your undergrad GPA. Now that didn't hit me too hard, but it was one of those things where I was thinking, you dummy, why didn't you just apply yourself and you wouldn't be in this position? And so I wrote a professor that was one of my favorites, but he was actually the chair of the theology department at Evangel University. He was over the entire thing. And without hesitation, he wrote back, you better believe it. And he wrote me this beautiful letter to get me into my master's program, which was in the business side. It was in organizational leadership. It wasn't even in the theology side. But he wrote me this letter, and he gave me this great recommendation. And so I knew that he was willing to put his name on my effort. He believed in me, and he had no reason to believe this. I don't think I got an A in his class. Maybe I did. But he had no reason to believe that Brandon Shank, the undergrad student who I wasn't even a 3, maybe a 2.7, 2.8, the undergrad student who didn't even make a 3.0, was going to come into this master's program. He wasn't going to quit. He wasn't going to fail out. I'm willing to put my name that this guy is going to crush it. Putting his reputation on the line with these other professors that he knows in this business department. They worked, it was the same college. And so I went into my master's program and ended up graduating with honors. And I don't tell you that because I'm being prideful. I tell you that because there was something about him validating me that made me want to work even harder to make sure that I showed that I'm honoring you because of the way you put your name on my back. There was something about it for me, and it showed me that, hey, you could have done this as your undergrad. I was a little bit more mature. I was a little bit different in life. But when I graduated with honors, with only a handful of us in my entire master's program that did that, he may never know, but it's that thing of he put his name on me, and so I wanted to make sure that I represented him well. And what I'm trying to tell you today is there's a God who has placed his name on you because he believes in you, and he sees things in your life that you can't see for yourself, and he is in love with you, and he is passionately pursuing you, and he's going to do great things through you. The biggest barrier that a lot of us face is there's a place that we just won't allow God to get to. And so we're absolutely enslaved by the brutality of where we're at. We're enslaved by addictions. We're enslaved by mindsets. And you wonder why you go through the same stuff. That's not your thing. I hate it when people say, well, that's just my struggle. That's accepting the fact that you're never going to be free. It's not just your struggle. What God wants you to do is to be free. And what the Bible is telling us is that we are overwhelmed by the brutality of our slavery, and we just accept where we're at. The Israelites were saying, just leave us in Egypt. And you know what? That's what darkness was. That's what Satan wanted for them. Because if they didn't leave Egypt, there was never a Red Sea that got divided. There was never an army that got dominated. There was never a people that walked around the walls of Jericho and the walls fell. There was never a people that was taking land and territory. There was never prophets that were going to speak out over the country. There was never things that were going to happen. The Messiah wasn't going to come the way that the Bible had said. He was trying to stop a move of God that was prophetic and already promised. And in your life, there is a prophetic word over your life that God has already set in place, and you can absolutely stop it if you want to. You can tell God no, and you can go down your own path, and we've all been there. But the brutality of the slavery and the place that you're in is not something to hold tightly to. It's saying, God, I want to give you everything. I want to give you everything. We make giving so much about money. You know what I hear from people who don't want to give money? Well, I give all my time to the church. You know what I hear about people who give all their money? Well, I don't have time, but I give all my money. Do you see how they're not even related? Because giving isn't about that. People always say, well, God tells us to tithe. Let me tell you a little bit about what the Bible says. The Old Testament tells us, do not commit adultery, right? Old Testament law. Do you know what Jesus says? Don't even look at a woman with a lustful eye. The Old Testament, it tells us not to murder. Do you know what the New Testament tells you? To love your neighbor as yourself, to give them above and beyond. The Old Testament, you know what it tells us? It talks directly about tithing. You know what the New Testament tells us? Give everything. You see, giving is about trusting God. Giving is about trusting God with things that you don't necessarily understand. Giving is about financially giving everything. If you do one or the other, it's because the other one has a hold. If you give everything financially, but you won't give who you are, it's because there's a hold. If you give everything in your time, but you won't give your finances, it's because there's a hold. And I want to help you see something. Scripture teaches us very clearly about the way that we are to give ourselves and the way that we are to give our life. But God describes it as, I want you to give everything. And we're really all over the map. We're at so many different places as people. We're at so many different places as organizations. And some of you may be new to Palms Church, and you'll know that money has never been a thing for us. I will talk about money as quick as I'll talk about serving, as quick as I'll talk about the blood of Jesus, because money is not an elephant in the room here, because we don't hit you up for it. God has provided for Palms, but his business plan for the church is tithing. God's business plan for the church is that the people who attend it would give everything. Because there's a mission, because people depend on us. And I can tell you, through this season, 1/3 of all Christians do no longer attend anywhere. People who consider themselves Christians, they're not going to church anywhere right now. And what it does is separating the wheat from the chaff. I want you to come back. If you haven't been here or somewhere else, go to church. You need the word of God in your life. I promise you, your life is not better, and you can admit that it's not when you get humble enough to realize that not being in church has made my life way worse, and my life is falling apart in a way that it never has because I haven't been connected to the things of God. We're at different places of the spectrum. You know, when it comes to giving, this is as spiritual as anything you're ever going to read about in Scripture. And what happens a lot of times is we won't equate giving with actual relationship. We equate it with an expectation that's not really God. Let me show you how this works. These are some different places of giving. This bottom tier, we're going to call this first-time giving, right? So we're going to step up to here. Some of you, this is where you're at. This is simply saying, I have never given anything ever, right? And you're going to learn really quickly here. This ceiling in this office is awful. You know, let me tell you something. We thrive in chaos here, so we make chaos into cupcakes. So what happened is we have a 1,200 square foot office. We don't have a building. So what we did, we just took everything we had and we made it a studio. So you're about ready to see the fine parts of the studio here at Palms Church. But this first time giving, this is just saying I've never given anything. So I would say start there. Give something. If it's a dollar, this is where some of us are at right here on first time. Right? And then for some of us, we've given one time, but for others, we might even give monthly. Recurring doesn't mean tithing, right? That's not what that means. This next step that I'm going to step up to, this is emotional, all right? So emotional giving, this is saying I give when I want, to who I want, and how I want. It's still about you. It's about you giving when you want. So when you're checking out of the grocery store and St. Jude's needs you to give to the hospital for Christmas, you know what you do? You give an extra 50 cents. Why? Because it's a guilt. Not that it's a bad thing. St. Jude's is great, but you're saying I give to who I want, when I want, and how I want. So you might hear what it does, it's a very unhealthy way to be a part of the church, because what you do is you say that was a good church or a good message, I'll give to it, instead of saying I'm committed to God. right? I'm committed to what he's doing. And so emotional giving, I don't ever give emotionally. I could be in the grocery store. I could be, there's somebody on the side of the road with a sign. People say, we need to give to the homeless. I give to the homeless. This church overflows in the way we give to other people. I give above and beyond. My wife and I have given above and beyond in our finances since we've been married. We have never had to measure out the percentages because giving is not about a percentage. It's about generosity. And so my wife and I have never struggled with the amount that we give. We have always given well above and beyond what comes in to our home. And we have given a ton, and we continue to. So I don't feel this emotional giving when I see somebody with a sign. And it doesn't mean that God doesn't speak to me at times, but I don't feel emotional giving when somebody says, hey, can you give to St. Jude's? I don't feel this tension. Because for me, I'm not an emotional giver. I'm a generous person, and I give a lot of what God gives me back, more than what he has asked in tithing. I give it back. I give it back to people. I give it back to things. I give it back to things that God puts on my heart. We give it to the church. So I'm not an emotional giver. And what this does is this is about us. Emotional giving makes us feel good, but it doesn't represent what God's actually asked us to do. See, none of the giving is bad. It's just you don't get to the biblical giving until you get to this one. You step up to tithing. So when you get to tithing, this is what happens. This is going to get interesting. When you get to tithing, this is what happens. Tithing is the business plan by God for the local church. People say, well, churches just want your money. If churches want your money, then that's between you and the church. I'm telling you this. I always say, God doesn't want your money. He wants your heart. Everybody in this studio just said it. Why? God's not after your money. You don't need trust in God. Listen to me. You don't need trust in God if you live off 100% of what you bring in. You're just a bad mortgage financing budgeteer. If you don't have enough money, it's because you're bad with money. If you don't tithe and you don't have enough, it's because you've spent more than you've been given. Period. If you don't tithe and you're living off 100%, you do not trust God with your money. Period. If you tithe, you're saying, God, I trust you because I'm only going to live off of 90% of what I get. This is the biblical teaching of tithing, right? So this is God's business plan for the church, tithing. All right? Now this next one, this is when it gets a little different. So you can't do offerings until you tithe. So you might say, well, man, I just give offerings. No, you don't. You're an emotional giver. You say, well, I give every month. Is it a tithe? If not, you're just an emotional giver. It's about you. It's about making you feel like you're doing what God's asked you to do. Emotional giving is not tithing. Emotional giving is about the giver, not about the gift and not about the God. You understand? Tithing is the biblical principle. It's the thing to say, I'm going to give to God. You're saying, why are you teaching this in the middle of the gift? Because the greatest gift ever given was Jesus. Jesus gave a gift so that we could give gifts. He gave a gift so we can give all of ourselves. And this is a huge part of it. Right now, the coronavirus, they got you scared. They're trying to take away all this different stuff. They're trying to save their stimulus packages. There is a lot of fear associated with money. And what God wants you to see is that when you give me your money, you don't have to worry about the fear. You don't have to, if you don't trust people with your money, trust God with your money and let him deal with the people. Don't make a church or a people to blame because you don't have faith. That's a cop out. Well, because what you're saying is you're righteous and they're not. You're faithful. You need to you need to trust God with that. Palms Church business plan is based around the faithfulness of the people that attend it. The faithfulness of the people that give. The faithfulness of the people that go before us. The faithfulness of that. Now, we have small overhead right now. We're in an office. I'm not preaching this out of necessity. I'm preaching this out of a product of saying, I have lived this and it works. And this is a biblical principle. You say, this isn't prosperity. God is a prosperity God. You give to him, you're blessed. That is absolutely the truth. How much you're blessed by it determines on how much you give. God will give you more. It's about your heart. The widow's mite. You give a penny or a million. Doesn't matter. What's your heart doing? It's the position of your heart. That's what God cares about. So tithing, the first biblical. And then we go to offerings. So this one, offerings are above your tithe. Offerings aren't saying, I mean, it's hot up here. I think heat rises, bro. The emotional giving says, I give what I want, when I want, and how I want. The offering says, I give what God wants, when God wants, who he wants to give it, and how he wants to give it. So this is above your tithe. You already give your tithe. This doesn't even have to be to the church. Casey and I give offerings outside of our church. We give offerings. We've supported a kid since we got married that's in another country. And then that kid got a job, and so they're no longer able to get our support, so we picked up another kid. It's the way it works. We support them. I will never meet this child on this side of heaven, but I'll get a colored picture and a picture every now and then. But I know that in heaven, when we do meet, I'm going to be able to look at that, and I hope that child can say, my family was different because of your faithfulness. Offerings are above your tithes. And there's other things we're part of, but that's a quick illustration. But offerings, you give those to anything. After you give them to the church, that's when the offering kicks in. This is saying, God, this is you. This is above my 10%. And then this last one, this is where it gets a little scary, okay? This is spirit-led giving. Let's see what we got here. Things get a little weird. Really bad dust allergies. That's all right. Spirit-led giving. It's dark. It's dark up here. A little weird. So spirit-led giving is whenever you you get to this top step, and I'll tell you, it's sketchy. This is a little scary. A little scary up here. The thing is, you can't live up here. You can't live up in spirit-led giving. You know why? Because it's not meant to live on. This is those moments where God speaks, you give $10,000, and you're like, I don't have $10,000. He's like, you will. Ask Justin April Huff. We have a testimony from last year. I'm not uncomfortable. I do a lot of air squats. So ask Justin April Huff last year. April Huff, God told her to give a certain amount. She said, we don't have that money. She said, but God, I'll commit it to you. And she had a move of God in her heart. She walks out to the mailbox. There's a check in the exact amount that day for what he told her to give to our one-day offering that we do every year here at Palms Church. You know what the one-day offering is? I'm about to tell you. One day is going to happen this year on December 20th, and it's an offering we take once a year, and it is going to be all online. You can click on the one-day tab on our giving page. Every dollar we bring in goes to things outside of Palms Church. Everything we do. So this spirit-led, you can't live up here. You can't, but God's going to ask you to be here every now and then, but you can't do this unless you're tithing. You can't tithe offering unless you've tithed, and you can't do spirit-led unless you're freely giving your money outside of your tithe. God's not going to ask you to give $10,000 when you're not tithing. He's not going to ask you to give $10,000 when you don't even know what it's like to give above your tithe to something that stirs your heart. Does this make sense? And so all these steps, they matter. I am sweating, bro. It's hot up here. I don't know what they got going on up there, but they got insulation, stuff falling on top of my shirt. Welcome to Palm Studio, baby. You guys got an inside look. I think there's a couple of cameramen up there, but I feel like I just took the Christmas tree out of the attic. This is the way that it works. Where are you at? You got to climb the ladder. You're somewhere on this ladder, and you know where you're at. Climb it. You got to climb this ladder. Are you a first-time giver? Are you emotional? Are you saying, I haven't given anything? Today, give a dollar. Give something. Go online and give a dollar and say, God, I'm going to trust you for the first time ever. Are you emotional? You have recurring giving, but you and I both know it's not a tithe. You're just doing it because it makes you feel good. Are you a tither where you're saying, God, 10% of everything you've given me, I have given back. Don't be a greedy donut hoarder. God gives you a box of 10. He said, can I get a donut? No. These are my donuts. Come on, man. Give the Lord a donut. How about offerings? How about offerings? Do you give above your tithe where it's not just about the money that you give? You see, I know people that are so calculated with their finances, they give to the dollar for tithing and they won't give offerings. That's not a cheerful heart. That's legalistic. That's what that is. I always round. You don't know why? I don't want to count. I don't want to count. I don't want to count what God gives me. I want to give to him freely. So yeah, there's a number that I give to this church and to different organizations. You better believe it. But I will always give above and beyond. Spirit-led, this is saying, God, I'm going to give you exponentially more. I'm going to give you so much more. My wife and I, during one of our years, we did a one day. We've done it for 2 years now. The first year we brought in, I think it was right around, I want to say $40,000. Our church was maybe 200 people at the time, 300 people. And we gave over $40,000. Last year we did this, we had over $75,000 come in for our one day offering in 2019. 2020, it's going to be up to you. I'm believing God for a miracle, but this is what you got to climb. The ladder. You got to figure out where you're at. You got to figure out what this looks like for you. You got to figure out what this next step's going to look like for you. You see, we're going to give to a lot of things this year. We're going to give to a lot of different organizations. We're going to give to Mid-Atlantic Teen Challenge. We are the parent church to that ministry. I'm the president of Mid-Atlantic Teen Challenge. And there are students right now who are addicted to drugs. Mid-Atlantic Teen Challenge is for young men who are addicted to drugs, and it's a 14-month recovery program. In fact, Terrell, who you saw on the drums this morning, he works at Teen Challenge. Right now, behind the camera, one of our production guys and one of our captains on our production team is a program director at Teen Challenge. Teen Challenge is a ministry for young men to overcome drug addictions, and it's an in-house 14-month program. Right now, we have young men all over the country that want in this program but can't afford it. So what we're going to do as a church is we're going to start giving money for scholarships because these students need to be able to get into the program and be able to find help. They need to be able to find some kind of hope. And we're going to do that. And so part of our one-day offering is going to go exclusively to Teen Challenge towards scholarships. And we, as a church, are going to start bringing in students to get into the program who need it, who right now are sitting in dark closets at home and are struggling with a drug addiction. You're going to be responsible for that. And right now, if your heart is stirring and God tells you something, you write it down because you're going to question it tomorrow. And you give that because this one day is going towards that. There's another ministry in Springfield, Missouri. One of my good friends, Pastor John Alred, he served time in federal prisons for crimes that are, you can read about. But Pastor John has been radically transformed, and he started a church called Freedom City. One day, my hope is that we have Freedom City at Palms Church. We have recovery programs for adults, and we have programs that'll help those coming out of prison get into back into life. And I want to be a part of these things. But Pastor John, in the last 3 years alone, they do have an intense church, an intense ministry, and they've seen over 1,200 people out of prison come to know Christ. Over 300 baptisms. We're going to give to them. They need help. A lot of the people that go to that church can't financially support a movement like that, but we can. We're a church that can come alongside Freedom City, and they can do things that we can't, and we're going to give to them, and we're going to watch God bless them. We're going to help them with their building right now that they're trying to get patched up and fixed up. We're going to help them become what God's calling them to be. We're going to give to a church plant that I just talked with this week that's launching out of LA this fall. We're going to be a part of that church plant. People that my wife and I are deeply connected to, we're going to believe for God to do the miraculous in that church plant, knowing that the city of Los Angeles, like every other city, needs Jesus. People need to know the Lord. We're going to watch God do the miraculous through this church plant. We're going to give to higher education and people that are trying to better themselves. We're going to help people who have become discouraged by their slavery, who have become overwhelmed by their addictions. We as Palms Church, it may be the middle of the coronavirus, but I'm telling you, this doesn't stop the move of God. Can we step up as a church? And in 2 weeks on December 20th, we're going to give our one day offering. And what I'm asking you to do is this. Why do I call it an offering? Not because we pass around plates. We never have here. We've done online from the get. I'll tell you why we call it an offering. Because if you don't tithe, don't give to it. This is a day where those of you who do not tithe, I'm asking you to start. And if you want to tithe that day and then give an offering, you can. But if you don't tithe, don't give the offering. Those of you who tithe and this is your home, I want you, or if this isn't your home, but you tithe somewhere and you're saying, I want to give to this. This isn't going towards our church. This is going towards these ministries that we are deeply connected with. Then that day on December 20th, I want you to give. There will be a portal online. You click on our giving page. You can click one day. You can start giving that week. We'll have it opened up the week of the 20th. I'm telling you now, because don't spend all that Christmas money. I'm telling you, God wants to use us to help deliver people from their slavery. And it's funny because you can pray and fast all you want, but there are things that only money can do on this side of heaven. And you give money to a student that can be scholarshiped in Mid-Atlantic Teen Challenge, you've helped that young man overcome the slavery that has tried to destroy his life. This isn't a guilt trip. Don't be emotional right now and give like it's a sad commercial about dogs that are being beaten. Those things are awful. But I'm not asking you to give emotionally. I'm asking you to give faithfully. I'm asking you to learn how to be a tither. You see why we've never done a building campaign? Let me tell you something. Palms Church has had multiple opportunities to have buildings in the last 5 years. In fact, we've looked at the same building for 4 years straight. And I went there last year, and they wanted to make a move on it, and they wanted us to take it. It was formerly a church. And I stood there, and the Lord and the Holy Spirit so clearly said to me, no, this isn't what I have. You know, the spring of this year, we went to a property here in Virginia Beach, a big property, lots of space for us to grow, a place we could even probably bring Teen Challenge on the campus. And we stood there, we talked to financial people, we tried to make it work. And you know what God said to me? No, this isn't what I have for you. What I'm trying to tell you is that we're not coming at a place of deficit. We're coming out of a place of vision. Palms Church is not in a place where we're trying to get you to give to. I'm telling you right now, this is God's business plan for the church. You need to tithe. You need to be faithful in your giving. And on December 20th, I want you to tithe. I want you to pray about giving an offering that is above and beyond what you're capable of giving right now. And I want you to give it. I have watched this play out in my life over and over and over and over again. A couple of weeks ago, the Lord spoke to me and he says, I'm giving you space. I didn't really know what that meant, but he said, I'm giving you space. And what God was speaking to me about was our home. My wife and I have lived in the same house for almost 6 years. It's not that big. We got four kids, but we didn't care. We were like, this is where we love it. This is where we're called. And I told my wife, I said, God told me he's given us space. And then my wife went into prayer about it. And she came out of her prayer closet about 2 weeks later and said, yeah, I just feel like the Lord said your time here is done. Like, I'm transitioning you. A place to host and to love and to open up your doors to even more and have more people and all this stuff. So we talked to some of the people closest to us, and they were all like, yeah, dude, your house is super small for all those kids. I'm thinking, why didn't anybody tell us? And we thought it was great. We thought we were living the life. We call it the Shank Estate, man. Everybody's like, man, your house is small, bro. I can't imagine all them kids. And I'm thinking, man, we had no idea. We were just content. We were content and little. We were content with what God had for our life. And the reason that I tell you this is because I told my wife about 2.5 weeks ago, I said, the Lord spoke to me. And he said, sell the RV, sell the truck, sell the house, and I'll provide a new one. I said, he's going to do it in order, and it's going to be fast. And she looked at me kind of weird. I said, it's just what he told me. I grew up in the mountains, so I love going to the mountains. I love campfires. I pull my RV for hours just to set it in the mountain so that when my kids go to bed, I love them, but I can just set that campfire up, kick my feet out, and see that deep, dark sky with stars and how I have that campfire crackling and the smell of it. That's vacation to me. And I told my wife, this is what he said he's going to do. So the week before Thanksgiving, the Monday before Thanksgiving, we sold the RV. I had it online 2 days. A week later, this past Monday, sold my truck. On Tuesday, we sold our house. 5 days, 40 showings. Tuesday, we sold our house. And then yesterday, we bought a house. Bam, 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 bam. You know why I tell you that? Because I didn't do it. And I wasn't even going to share it with you today. And the reason I'm crossing my arms is probably because I'm a little insecure about it. I wasn't going to tell you because I don't share some of the intimate details of my life because I don't want people to feel like they carry weight. And my wife's always like, you need to tell more. Like, yeah, but I don't know if I'm comfortable sometimes. Maybe it's just me. I don't feel comfortable. But the reality was God said, no, tell them about me. Tell them about me. Adam, who's behind the camera, has been with us since he was in fifth grade. And I told him last night, and he was sending pictures of little kids drinking milk falling over because he's saying he was celebrating with us, saying he was going to pop that apple cider, sparkling cider, and just spray it all over the house, you know, just because he's excited for us because he's seen our life. And a lot of people around us have been, we got videos, we told our team and some of our parents, and we were getting people crying. We got videos sent to us, and everybody was like, we are so excited for you guys. And I looked at Casey, and I said, was this house that small? She said, no, I think people just see when you're faithful to God, they want what God has. And I said, well, I just didn't realize that we made that big of a sacrifice. And she says, yeah, but when you're content and little, he'll give you much. We bought a dream home. It's not because we're millionaires, it's because God is. And because he said, I quite frankly don't need anything you got. I'm just going to give this to you. And it's funny because the one thing anybody knows me could tell you is that dude could care less about stuff. Anybody that knows me would be like, that dude could care less. I like shoes. I like nice things. But honestly, I can just give a rip about them because it's brick and mortar, man. The building's not going to be here in 150 years. That thing you drive, no matter how nice and shiny, it's gone. But you know what I can tell you? When Casey and I had nothing, we gave everything. I don't use my life as an illustration often, but I felt like today God said, you tell him who I am. Don't you hold back. You tell him who I am, because I am the great I am, and they need to know that. We had nothing. We had a house foreclosed on in 2007. I remember getting those papers from a lawyer when I was in my mid-20s, basically, and a homeowner, a guy who wanted out of a contract, that basically wrote me this nasty email and told me how much of a loser I was because I couldn't hold a house. We weren't even living in it at the time. We were in Missouri, and I was traveling and preaching, and I felt like I was doing the Lord's work. Satan was doing his. You know, it was just a mess. And here I am 13 years later buying a home I never thought I could get, not because we are making a killing, but because God is in the business of miracles. Don't be jealous when people are blessed. Know that God loves blessed people, and he wants to bless you, and he has. Just look around you. He wants to bless your life, man. He wants to do it. But he can't bless you with the prayers you're praying if you're not giving. He can only bless your life to the level of which you're willing to be blessed. And if you're not tithing, you don't trust God. You can say whatever you want. If you can't live off of what you make, you just need to learn how to manage your money better. And we have financial peace. We have things that we can offer. But what you need to do is that you have to figure out how to live on what God's given you. And not take from God to live. Because if you're living on 100%, you don't need God. You're just a bad budgeter. But you live on 90, and I promise you, your life is going to change. God is faithful. You know, the Israelites did get out of Egypt, and they did get to the sea, and the sea in front of them and the Egyptians behind them. And in Psalm chapter 77, something crazy happens. What happens starts in verse 16. It says, when the Red Sea saw you, O God, its waters looked and trembled. The sea quaked to its very depths. The clouds poured down rain. The thunder rumbled in the sky, and your arrows of lightning flashed. Your thunder roared from the whirlwind. The lightning lit up the world. The earth trembled and shook. Your road led through the sea. Listen to this. your pathway through the mighty waters, a pathway no one knew was there because it didn't exist. And it says, you led your people along that road like a flock of sheep with Moses and Aaron as their shepherd. A pathway that no one knew was there. And in your life, you may be devastated because you feel overwhelmed by the brutality of your slavery and discouraged because of where we're at and because of what you feel like you haven't been able to do and who you haven't been able to see and things you haven't been able to do. But if you give not your money, but your all, then I promise you that you're gonna have a pathway made in your life that you can't see. You're gonna have things start to map out and seas open. And the Bible makes sure to tell you that it wasn't mucky ground. It wasn't muddy ground. It was dry ground because God makes the path and it accommodates you to be able to walk through it. And today you're not in a struggling place because of a God that doesn't make promises and keep them. It's because of a faith that has weakened. And the greatest gift ever given to us, his name is Jesus. And today he's asking us to give gifts to those who are bound by their slavery, who are distracted and discouraged and are suicidal and on the verge of collapse. He's asking us, Palms Church, and you may say, well, that's me today. There's no greater way to find freedom and deliverance than by helping those who have theirs. And I'm absolutely putting it on us today to say we're doing one day on December 20th. Would you pray about what you're not able to give and give it? Would you pray about helping us help these students who can't get out of drug addictions and adults coming out of prisons and more people even baptized in prisons? Would you pray today about helping us reach those and help those who can't help themselves? We have the ability. So the Bible says don't stand by. When you have water to give, then give it. When you have food to give, then give it. And today I'm challenging you. Don't be a first. You can be a first-time giver. That's wonderful. It's a start. Don't be an emotional giver. I give when I want to, how I want to who I want to. But start with the biblical basis for what business plan God has for the church and tithe. Say, God, I'm giving you 10% of everything I have, and then you give your offering. And for some of you, be spirit-led in that. Give something that makes you so uncomfortable that you're not sure how you're going to make it. That's when God can move. You know why? Not because of the amount you give, but because of the way your heart is opened. Spirit-led giving isn't about the amount. It's about the heart that's saying, this is all I have. That's why the widow's mite story is so powerful, because it wasn't that she gave such a small amount that the story is big. It's because she gave all she had, and it was just a small amount. God wants to do it to you today. Listen, giving is how we fight those discouraged by the brutality of their slavery. You want to fight for those people discouraged by the brutality of their slavery? Give, like Moses and Aaron. Moses left his vocation. Aaron left what was comfortable. They left the country. They left things. Moses left his father-in-law and all that he knew and took his wife, and they uprooted, and they were the first church planters, and they took this Israelites, and they took them out, and they kept going in front of the president, the king, and they finally got him across the sea, and he marched in the desert for the rest of his life to bring people to freedom. And I'm telling you, God's not asking you to give a tithe. He's asking you to give everything. And today, hey, Palms Church, can we be the church that does things a little different right now in this moment? Can we not be a church that's calculating accounts, but a church that is bowing down and worshiping to the Almighty, to the Most Holy, saying, you are my King. Oh God, thank you for your faithfulness over me and my life. Thank you for your faithfulness over me and my house. I want you right now to just thank God. Can you do that? Can you thank him? Oh God, we thank you. If you don't know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, I want you right now just to say, dear Jesus, forgive me. I surrender to you. I give you my life in Jesus' name. And if you say that prayer, write the words me in the chat. We want to follow up with you. But I want you right now, can you just thank God for your faithfulness? You say, God, I thank you for your faithfulness. Come on, he's given you more. You can watch this on some digital device. He's given you more than enough. He's given you more than enough. God, you're faithful. Oh God, you're faithful to me. You're holy and you're righteous. God, thank you for providing for Casey and I and for Caden and Rylan and Makai and Asher. Thank you for providing us a place to live. Thank you for providing us a place that we could never have on our own. Thank you for going before us. Oh God, thank you for the nights that Casey and I have held one another and cried and been worried about financial things, and you have come through in ways that only you could. Oh God, thank you for the way that you have loved us, and no matter what we did, whether we were starting ministries or starting churches, you have been faithful and you have been out in front of us and you have never let us down. Oh God, I thank you right now on behalf of my family. You are faithful, God. And Lord, we will give to you. I want to be a spirit-led giver. Holy Spirit, I want to lead. I want to lead my home. I want to lead my wife. I want to lead Palms Church. I want to be a spirit-led church. I want to be a spirit-led man of God, that walks in an anointing. Would you just speak that to him right now? Can you ask God to give you the courage? It's going to take you taking a step out. I want you to get uncomfortable in this season. Our greatest times are when the darkest night happens. Church, we should be lighter right now than anything. As darker it gets, the brighter we become. We need to give to this movement that God is calling us to. There are people that depend on us. We can't sit back and ask about our faith. Let's not be selfish in our life and just ask God to do for us. Let's go for people. I believe in it today. I want you to lift your hands wherever you're at, and I want you to sing the faithfulness of God over your life, and I want you to know that he's with you. He will give you what to give, and when you do it, it'll change everything. Come on. Jesus. Let's be tithers. Let's be offering givers. Let's be spirit-led. I'm praying for December 20th, our one day. And I'm praying for you. He's faithful. We love y'all.
Great is his faithfulness. I am fired up right now, just believing for God to show up in a mighty way as we step out and we praise his name with every aspect of our life. And we give him everything, our finances, our heart, our lives. Give it up to God. And I'm believing that God's going to show up and show off as you give him everything.
It's such a powerful word each and every week. But I'm telling you, I just see this picture of freedom. I see this picture of freedom for people who are given. I see this picture of freedom for those that were given to, walking out of that bondage that they're in. And there's no better way to make your life great than to give to somebody else to look out for their life. And if you want to give today, all you've got to do is text GIVE and the amount to 84321. Or go to palmschurchonline.com and you can give that way as well.
Yeah, and if you want prayer today, if you want prayer over just taking this next step and taking him and giving God your full heart, giving God your finances, giving him everything, we have a prayer team that is ready, and they're going to believe with you. They're going to pray with you. They're going to proclaim the goodness of God over you. So I'm going to encourage you right now, click on the chat. Don't wait. Click on the link in the chat. Join that Zoom room, and we have a prayer team that's going to pray and believe with you for the supernatural.
Yeah, that's awesome. And don't forget about our marriage conference, our Together conference, Thursday and Friday. Get signed up today. If you're not signed up, go on and sign up now. We'll put a link in the chats for you, but get signed up for that. And don't forget about our Palms Connect groups as well. We have these two-week devotionals, and we want you guys to get plugged in. They start today. So you got to get signed up, get plugged in, press in during this time. God has something amazing for your life, but you got to take that step to press in and get connected.
So much going on this week, so make sure be a part of Palms Groups Together Conference. We got lots going on, so hey, click on those, go to our website. All the information that you need is on there. We will see you all on a Wednesday for our Wednesday night live worship. Love you all. Have a fantastic week.